All right, this is
chapter 9, problem 76. Gives us what we talked about previously as being kind of an Atwood machine. So there's a pulley, it's being suspended from the ceiling, and it is hooked up to two different masses, one of which is currently flush on the ground, and the other is suspended up in the air. It tells us that this has a mass of 30 kilograms, and this has a mass of 20 kilograms, and that this object has a height of 2 meters above. It also tells us some information about the pulley. I need to scroll up so I can read the whole problem. The pulley has a radius of 10 centimeters and a mass of 5.0 kilograms. Okay, I'll make sure that I can see that all right. The question asks us specifically for the speed of the 30 kilogram block just before it hits the ground, right? We have a large block here, a block of a mass at least that's greater than the mass on this side, and so we know that there's going to probably be, very likely be a net force that's greater on this block that's going to cause some acceleration as this system moves forward. We've dealt with this problem before where we considered the pulley to be some disk that is massless and frictionless or something like that. So the objects move very, very simply, right? We applied Newton's second law two different times and we got the final result. What we do know about this, we knew a lot of the information is still very, very relevant. We just need to make sure what the subtle differences are. So there's a weight force. We can draw two different force diagrams for this problem. One where we have this is M2. I'm going to call this M2, mass 2, and this mass 1. So mass 2 has a tension force pulling up on it that's equal to T2, and some weight pulling down. Its weight. Weight force pulling down, right? We know that that's going to be equal to its mass, M2 times gravity. Similarly, for the first mass, we have something similar where we have a tension force up and the weight pulling down. I'm going to draw these appropriately because we know that the weight here is going to be larger than the tension pulling up, and here we know that the tension pulling up is going to be larger than the weight pulling down because we're going to see these objects move from one another because one of the masses is much larger than the other. What's different about this problem than even the problem we did just previously where we had a massless, frictionless pulley, in this case we don't. We have a massive pulley, there's some friction between the rope and the pulley so that this pulley is going to begin to rotate. So we need to make sure that we consider what the values of these tensions are. They're no longer going to be equal to one another because the tension in this rope is pulling down. It's actively doing two things. It's starting the motion of this pulley. It's changing some of that, the force acting on it is beginning to rotate the pulley, and some of that tension is going, some of that force is being used to lift up the other mass. So we can just begin to write down our Newton's second law expressions, the sum of the forces. The net forces is going to be equal to the mass times acceleration for each of these bodies, right? So we start off with this object here, M2. So we know the sum of the forces, that's tension 2 up minus its weight, which is M2 times G, is going to be equal to its mass, M2, times its acceleration, A. Okay. For the other object, the 20 kilogram mass, we know that its tension up in the positive direction minus its weight down, M1G, will equal its mass times its acceleration. Now, while the tensions here aren't equal to one another, the accelerations of these two things are. They're going to have to accelerate at the same rate, or else we'd have some bunching of the cord or some weird thing where we'd have these reaching different speeds at different times. And that's obviously not going to happen, or else the string would break or something weird would have to occur. The other Newton's second law that we can write is that for the rotational, a Newton's second law of rotation for our pulley. And the way that we wrote that in class is Newton's second law for rotation, instead of net forces, we rely on net torque. And that's going to be equal to the moment of inertia of our rotating object times its angular acceleration, right? So where the force to torque, mass to moment of inertia, and tangential acceleration to angular acceleration. The tensions acting on this disk may be a little bit unclear. I'm going to redraw the pulley right here. So what, think about the forces that are acting on this pulley. What kind of forces does it feel? Well, it feels the tension of this rope pulling down on its right side. So there's a force pulling down here that's equal and opposite of tension 2. How do we know it's equal and opposite? Well, if it wasn't, it would break at this point, right? If there was some type of, if the two tensions weren't equal to one another, the rope would break in some way, right? It would either pull back or it would be pulled forward. They have to be equal to one another. In just the same way that we have tension 1 on this side pulling down, right? There's the tension 1 in this rope is actually pulling up on this block. It's pulling up on this block, but the force that the pulley feels is a torque pulling down. And the reason there's a torque is each of these forces is over the distance, the radius of the pulley R. So then when we go to calculate this, we find the net torque is equal, we can choose any direction to be positive. So let's choose the counterclockwise direction to be positive. Or in that case, that would be, we use our right-hand rule, we would say that would be up and out of the page. But so if we consider the types of forces that would cause this positive motion, this would be the positive value, right? So we'll do that one first. T1 times the radius, to be really careful, we would do R cross F, right? This should really be the radius cross the force acting on it, which is tension 1, minus the lever arm times its tension force. And as we can see, we take, for the first one, we take R cross F, and that gives us a torque up. And for the other one, we take R cross F, and we get a tension pointing down, right? So there we can justify that minus sign that's there, right? These are each doing different things. So normally that's actually a sum. Then when we actually do the cross product, we see that this is really R times T1 in a positive direction, and this is R times T2, but a negative direction, because it's going the opposite way, right? So that is going to be equal to the object's moment of inertia times its angular acceleration. Okay, so then now, and also because this is rope is moving, isn't moving with respect to the pulley, it's actually causing the pulley to rotate without slipping, we know that the angular acceleration is going to equal to the tangential acceleration divided by its radius as well. All right, and this is also a disk. We know the moment of inertia is going to be equal to 1/2 mr squared. So let's actually plug all those things in real quick, and we're going to see something awesome that happens. So we have, this is an r in both of these terms. Let's take an r out of both of these two terms. So it's r times t1 minus t2 equal to the moment of inertia, 1/2 mr squared, where this is the mass of the pulley, right, times alpha, which is a over r. And then, wow, look what happened. We have an R here, and we have an R squared on top and an R on the bottom. If we divide both sides by R, this R cancels and with one of these R's, and this R cancels with the other R. So our Newton's second law for rotation actually gives us a third equation, which relates these two tensions with the mass of the pulley and the tangential acceleration that it experienced along its outer edge. So then we have one equation, two equations, three equations, and 1, 2, 3 unknowns in these three equations. Everything else is known. We know what mass 2 is, we know what mass 1 is, we know what gravity is, we know what the mass of the pulley is. So then we kind of use those, we plug those all together. Probably the quickest way to do that is to just plug in for T2 and T1 into this third equation. So we take T1 as being M1 times A, plus m1g, and then we minus t2, which t2 is m2a plus m2g. And yeah, we just plugged each of those in, and then that's going to be equal to 1/2 the mass of the pulley times its acceleration. We're going to make sure we distribute this negative sign to both of these terms, and now we're going to put the a's all on one side. So our left side will be m1 minus m2. So we're going to take the leading terms of all of the a's out. If we subtract this to this side, we'll get a minus 1/2 mp. That times a. And on the right-hand side, we're going to get This is a minus m2g and a positive.